Hi guys, today's topic is one that I've been wanting to do for a long time now. I figured it should be covered before Vega arrives. So, what is it about? Well, you often hear these mantras repeated that in DirectX 11, AMD has more driver overhead, or somehow NV's drivers are more efficient. While in DirectX 12 or Vulcan, we often hear the reverse, that AMD is better at next-gen APIs. That's the observed effect, yet there's been few in-depth attempts at explaining why. It is a very complex topic to delve into. It took me a while to think of how best to explain in a simple concept in a way that allows gamers to better appreciate the journey of both Nvidia and AMD in recent times. Before I start, just let me make this disclaimer. I'm just a software guy, unaffiliated with any of these corporations. What I present is based on my own understanding. I could be wrong, it's ultimately up to you if you're curious enough to do your own research if you have doubts about what I say. In order to tell this tale and do it justice, we have to go on a short trip back in history. Let's start with Fermi, the architecture responsible for the GTX 480, the really hot, loud, and power-hungry beast from Nvidia back in 2010. The biggest reason why it was so power-hungry was it actually had a very powerful hardware scheduler with advanced features that predate AMD's GCN architecture. Fermi had very fast context switching, allowing it to interweave graphics and compute workloads quickly. It also supported concurrent execution of multiple different kernels, allowing for physics or CUDA to run in parallel with graphics rendering. Do these features sound familiar? It should, because it's DirectX 12 and Vulcan capable. Nvidia just never enabled it in their drivers. The problem with Fermi was TSMC's early 28nm was horrible, and it exacerbated the power usage. Nvidia did tame Fermi with a redesigned chip in the GTX 580, but that initial hot and power-hungry problem badly hurted Nvidia's pride. This would revolutionize the way Nvidia designed GPU architectures afterwards, with everything focused on power efficiency. With Kepler, Nvidia decided to remove a major part of the hardware scheduler, making it purely dependent on software or drivers to process and optimally distribute workloads to the GPU, and this led to a good increase in efficiency. Interestingly, just when Nvidia moved away from hardware scheduling, AMD moved to one in the new GCN architecture. The reason is multifaceted, but it involves the Fermi Teslas dominating high-performance computing and supercomputing workloads, where having a good hardware scheduler is a big advantage. AMD wanted to chase after this lucrative market, so they had to have a powerful and dynamic GPU compute architecture. Secondly, AMD worked with Sony to develop GCN, and on the console they have APIs that are vastly different and superior to Windows PCs. Now, with that short hardware history out of the way, let's move into the inner details of how AMD and Nvidia's drivers currently operate with these different APIs. Let's start with a typical DirectX 11 game, light on all thread utilization, but very heavy on the primary thread. With AMD up to now and Nvidia prior to the last few years, how this works is that the draw code processing in DirectX 11 is restricted to the main rendering thread. Even if a game utilizes 1 to 2 threads, with the rest idling, that game can become CPU bound really quick. DirectX 11 actually has a way to reduce this single-thread bottleneck to better use multi-cores called command lists or deferred contexts. But back then, nobody bothered with it. Being single-thread bound was the status quo back in the days, as game devs were reliant on higher clocked and higher IPC CPU architectures to remove the bottleneck. It took a few years after DirectX 11 came out for a game to use its multi-thread command list features. That game was Civilization V, with the engine developed by some of the guys now at Oxide, like Dan Baker, the creators of the Nitrous engine and Ashes of the Singularity. A well-written summary from Anantech's editor Ryan Smith is available in the forum that covers this topic way back in 2011. How DirectX 11 multithreading works is by breaking down draw code submission into an immediate context and a deferred context. Within this deferred context, you pile up your draw calls, and when it's time to send to the GPU, you assemble or batch them into a command list and submit that to the GPU. The submission is still based on the primary thread, but now the extra cores or threads on the CPU can assist in batching up draw calls. It's a semi-approach to multi-thread rendering. Suddenly, Nvidia GPUs were twice as fast as Civilization V at low resolution where it's CPU bound. Even AMD at the time admitted that such an approach could yield twice the performance. We will go back to this figure later, but it's important to note that this improvement requires both drivers and game developers to code in a specific way to take advantage of it. To better explain this, I've made a diagram which simplifies DirectX 11 multi-threading. Instead of having the usual main thread maxing out due to running heavy game logic as well as all the draw code processing and submission, DirectX 11 can split up that draw code processing, offloading some of the work to the worker threads on the other cores. When the worker thread finishes, the data is assembled into a command list for submission. This process can improve performance in situations where the main thread is heavily loaded, but there's an associated cost as some CPU cycles are required to split up the workloads and more for combining them into command lists. Basically, there's an added CPU overhead cost to this approach. But back in 2011, most games rarely max out cores 2 onwards, so this approach was the perfect solution. Returning back to the twice the performance increase, why not 3 times or 4 times more as you increase the CPU cores? It's down to the nature of the process itself. Splitting up draw cores into batches cannot scale indefinitely. There are dependencies and complexity increases as the more cores you scale your rendering to, as they eventually have to recombine into the primary thread for submission. Typically, a return of twice the performance throughput for command list usage is a good result. Now, here's the kicker, the real magic of Nvidia's driver team. After Nvidia saw the huge benefit from Civilization V's use of DirectX 11 command lists, they were working behind the scenes on how to bypass the need for developers to multi-thread DirectX 11 games, a way to use more cores regardless of developer coding. Their solution is a brilliant one, often rarely discussed in public, and the simplest way to explain it is that Nvidia's driver has an active server thread that monitors draw calls. If it's not sent as a deferred context for command list preparation, the server process intercepts and slices the workloads up, sending it to worker threads to process and eventually assemble a command list. It sounds easy, but trust me, it is not. This feature is a marvel of software engineering. With the new multi-threaded DirectX 11 drivers, Nvidia GPUs suffer much less primary CPU thread bottlenecks. It essentially only needs a small portion of the primary thread to run the server process for batching with worker threads on the other CPU cores. Games that are single-threaded suddenly run great on Nvidia GPUs. Examples like World of Tanks or Arma 3, single-thread bound, runs much faster on Nvidia GPUs. Even 3DMark's DirectX 11 API overhead test runs almost identical for Nvidia GPUs in single-thread or multi-thread mode. As a side effect, intensive CPU physics in games have almost no performance impact for Nvidia GPUs, again because it's immune to the primary thread bottlenecks. At this point, you have to ask, if DirectX 11 command list is so good, why can Nvidia implement it but AMD cannot? It comes down to one major difference. Nvidia's GPU uses a software scheduler or the driver. After the draw calls are sent to the scheduler, it decides how to distribute the workloads in an optimal manner into the compute units or SMX. Note that this compiling or scheduling has an inherent CPU cost associated with it, so it's not a free lunch, but in many low-thread games, lots of CPU resources are left untapped, so this software scheduling overhead is hidden. Because the main scheduler for Nvidia is software-based, it can accept many command lists, even very large ones, as they are buffered for execution. In contrast, AMD GPUs have a hardware scheduler. Both the global and the warp scheduler are present on-chip. The driver does not schedule, it just passes it to the GPU for the hardware scheduler to handle. By design, AMD's hardware scheduler relies on more immediate context or a constant stream of draw calls entering, not big packets or a command list that has to be stored prior to execution. Basically, AMD's hardware scheduler lacks the ability or mechanism to properly support constant usage of DirectX 11 command lists. So when AMD claims that they did not focus on multi-threading DirectX 11, and instead focus on breaking through the draw code ceiling directly with a new API like Mantle, you can understand why. It's not that they can't, but they won't. It's simply because the GCN architecture is not capable of multi-threading well under DirectX 11's restrictions. This isn't to say that DirectX 11 with AMD is awful. Games can be coded to run really well on AMD for DirectX 11. They just need to be well threaded with the game logic and able to leave the primary rendering thread mainly to handle draw calls and submission to the GPU. An example, you may have heard of the Total War series. The previous ones like Attila or Empires were single threaded and ran very badly on AMD GPUs. With the recent Total War Warhammer, AMD partnered with Creative Assembly to focus on multi-threading the engine and adding DirectX 12. The result is that AMD GPUs run this game very well in both DirectX 11 and 12, and that's just down to proper game thread usage. However, the reverse is also true. Games can be coded to really hurt AMD performance. It's just a simple matter of loading more game logic to the primary thread like CPU intensive effects, AI, or physics. With the main thread fully loaded, draw calls to AMD GPUs get stalled and GPU utilization and performance drops. This happens in some games and it has led to the incorrect belief that AMD has worse DirectX 11 driver overhead. Contrary to what the mantra suggests, as games become more threaded, it can benefit AMD if the game logic is spread to all the threads, keeping the rendering thread free for draw calls. While the inverse can also be true, in games that are well threaded and CPU intensive, Nvidia's GPU can suffer both from the overhead of DirectX 11 command list and also from the software scheduler. In simple terms, when a game pushes all threads, the extra overhead reduces the CPU cycles available for game logic, and the frame rate slows down as a consequence when there's not enough CPU power. Or, if the CPU is powerful enough, it results in a higher CPU usage for a similar frame rate. We can see this typically in recent generation of multi-threaded console ports, such as Call of Duty Black Ops 3 benchmarked here with a GTX 970 and an RX 480. Note the 970 is fully maxing the 4 CPU cores while outputting lower frame rates than the 480, which still has CPU resources in reserve. Again in Crysis 3 on a quad core, similar frame rates but much higher CPU utilization on the 970 and 1060. This is the DirectX 11 command list and software scheduling overhead. It takes CPU cycles to perform these tasks. This cost is often hidden because most games do not stress all CPU threads so highly. The same can be seen in The Witcher 3 in Novigrad, where the game becomes CPU bound on a quad core. Again, similar frame rates for all three GPUs, but note the CPU usage is maxed for Nvidia while the RX 480 still has ample reserves. It is a specific phenomenon whereby games are both CPU intensive and multi-threaded, but they also leave the rendering thread free for draw calls for AMD GPUs to function well. When you actually think about it, it is actually Nvidia's driver that has higher CPU overhead, as it needs more CPU cycles to function. The reason they benefit with this approach is because games have been very slow to push multi-threading. Think back from 2012 to 2015. Most titles barely use two threads, and so a lot of CPU threads remain idle. Meanwhile, during these years, AMD GPUs suffer in some DirectX 11 games, and people falsely assume they have higher driver overhead. Games today still do not come close to pushing the draw call ceiling even for AMD's CPUs. The problem all along was that these games fully loaded the main rendering thread. To summarize the DirectX 11 situation, the correct statement is that Nvidia GPUs have a higher CPU overhead, it uses more CPU cycles, but can potentially have much higher DirectX 11 draw calls if there's idling CPU resources. Inversely, AMD's driver is more direct to the GPU, but is very weak against rendering thread bottlenecks. As for the situation on DirectX 12 and Vulcan, adoption has been quite slow and many studios designed their games for both DirectX 11 and these APIs. It is not the approach that yields the best results for either DirectX 12 or Vulcan, as these APIs require ground-up engine redesign to truly benefit. The reason DirectX 12 and Vulcan benefits AMD's GPUs is because the GCN architecture was designed for an API that can fully tap into its hardware scheduler. DirectX 12 and Vulcan natively allows draw call processing and submission on all CPU threads. On AMD, this directly goes to the hardware scheduler, which can have 64 independent queues for distribution to the compute units. In some ways, these new APIs are removing the shackle that AMD GPUs have been carrying in the DirectX 11 era. In regards to Nvidia's DirectX 12 and Vulcan, because of its software scheduler, there's some overhead to separate draw call submissions across many threads, as the streams have to be reassembled. This is usually not a big impact, considering draw call potential of DirectX 12 or Vulcan, but when games don't stress draw calls and are not coded to scale as well as Nvidia's DirectX 11 drivers, performance can regress. However, when done right by a good developer, both of these new APIs have big potential for future games that push scene complexity much higher than currently. We are still at the verge of truly meaningful performance gains with these APIs because game complexity has somewhat stagnated due to the current console generation limiting game design complexities. Knowing these differences between AMD and Nvidia's strategy, can we conclude which approach is better? I think we can. Clearly, Nvidia has been winning, and still winning, with market share, revenue, and profits. However, it puts AMD's approach in perspective. As an underdog, they had to gamble with Mantle to spur on real next-gen APIs that fully tap into the GCN architecture, as well as the high core count FX CPUs. If AMD did not push Mantle, the DirectX 11 would live on for much longer, and that is simply not in AMD's interest. Meanwhile, Nvidia moved towards software scheduling that benefits from an API that works best with more driver intervention, and they invested heavily in maximizing the DirectX 11 capabilities. It is therefore in their interest to ensure that DirectX 11 remain the target API for as long as possible. Moving forward, what is the optimal strategy for AMD and Nvidia? Note that their strategies do not align. What is good for one is bad for the other. AMD needs Vulcan and DirectX 12 to be adopted faster with more multi-threaded game engines, and this is particularly important now with Ryzen CPUs in the market. AMD's main advantage here is the 8-core Jaguar CPUs in the major consoles which dictate game studio optimizations. However, Nvidia has more money, and simply put, they can dictate how games are optimized for the PC port. In this kind of competitive battle, Nvidia has a huge advantage because money matters here. It allows more engineers on-site with game devs, and it allows more studio sponsorships. This ultimately results in Nvidia having a major say in how the PC port is coded. And assuredly, next-gen API or not, they will make it run superior on their GPUs. Therefore, AMD has no choice but to design the hardware to be more resilient against Nvidia's strategy. AMD started with Polaris. The discard accelerator nullifies any tessellation bottlenecks. The improved hardware scheduler and instruction prefetch slightly alleviates primary thread bottlenecks. Vega has to take this further. It has to improve its hardware scheduler and shader efficiency because DirectX 11 is still going to be important in the foreseeable future. It's going to be a very interesting few years ahead as we witness these great tech companies battle it out. This we can be sure of. If you stuck around for this long, things will start to add up and perhaps something clicks in your mind regarding Ryzen's odd gaming performance. Because of Nvidia's software scheduler and DirectX 11 multi-threading, if it is not optimized for a new CPU architecture like Ryzen with its unique CCX design, it could negatively impact performance in a few ways. First, the software scheduler under DirectX 12, with each thread submitting draw calls, the reorganization and optimization of these multiple sources has high thread data dependencies. In DirectX 11, the auto multi-threading feature constantly splits up draw calls into multiple worker threads, then reassembles them into a command list. This, again, is a high thread dependency task. If these trips across the CCX to share or sync thread data happens often, there's extra latency. This is exacerbated when reviewers test low resolution, very high frame rates, as each frame now has to be rendered by the CPU much faster, the latency penalty kicks in. With AMD's GPUs both in DirectX 11 and 12, draw call submission is thread independent, as the draw calls get sent straight to the GPU's hardware scheduler. This is not to say that there aren't other problems with Ryzen, such as game-specific optimizations or Windows thread management. But there's no multi-threaded, thread-dependent GPU drivers that can compound the problem. I've been waiting to see whether any tech journalists would go down this route, and as expected, most of the tech press aren't interested in delving deep. There's actually an alarming lack of curiosity for a profession that demands it. However, it's refreshing to see a certain YouTuber, Jim at Adore TV, has uncovered the surface of this issue. You guys no doubt have seen it. If you have not, I will link it in the description. It's a brilliant piece of tech journalism. This video has been in the back of my mind for a long while now, as I thought about how best to present it. Hopefully this has been satisfactory and insightful for you guys. And by the way, I'm sorry for the voice, I've got a nasty cold. Until next time.